It is I, your humble host, Bill Hatch, the third, coming to you live from the palatial home studios of Bald Spots Productions here in the beautiful city of Santa Ana, California. Joining me, as per the usual, in studios, my friend, my brother in Christ, the disembodied voice of Rudy.
Hey, everybody, I love y'all. Walk with the Lord.
And joining us from a more than acceptable safe social distance through the miracle of telephony are my guests for this today, this evening, whatever you happen to be watching. We've got Dr. Janice Fletcher. Where are you calling from, Dr. J?
I'm right down the street from you. I'm in Laguna Niguel, California.
Oh, awesome. I love Laguna Niguel. There's a couple of really great restaurants down there. Brisas? Las Brisas, I think, is the name of one of them. Yeah, I had a really good brunch there once. And also joining us today is my other guest, Pat Daly. How you doing, Pat?
I'm doing well, and you?
I am peachy. Running on very little sleep as per the norm, which means you get Happy Jollyville.
All right.
So where are you calling from? Because you've been on the show before.
Yep. Houston, Texas.
Houston. Planet Houston. Okay. Yep. So a beautiful state, plenty of great barbecue, that's for sure.
Sure.
Well, let's see. Where to get started? I've had an idea for a new starting question. What are you reading?
Well, just yesterday, I somehow began to read Spare about Prince Harry. Okay. And it grabbed me. It did. So at the end of whatever pages they gave me, I paid $18 for the full book.
Wow.
So, yeah, I wasn't planning on doing that, but that's what I'm reading.
Okay.
Is it still proper to call him Prince, though?
I mean,
has he disassociated himself from that whole royalty thing?
Well, I haven't read that far. However, what do you call him? Mister? That'd be weird.
Yeah. Maybe Harry.
Harry, yeah. That's, you know. I don't know. To be continued. I don't know.
Yeah. I think he's just given up the money, not the title, but I could be wrong about that. I'm not sure how much I'd enjoy being called Prince.
Even a fairly famous guy changed his name away from it to an unpronounceable symbol, right?
Yep. One of the greatest guitarists to ever live. That's for sure. A performer of no mean feats. Have you ever seen Prince's performance at the Super Bowl halftime show? That is an amazing commitment. He was dancing around in high heels on a glass stage in the rain.
Yeah.
A lesser performer, I think, would have said, "Not going to do it."
Yeah.
But wow. How did we go from Prince Harry to Prince?
Yeah, his Purple Highness.
His Purple Highness, yes. The late, great Purple Highness. So, Pat, how about you? What are you reading?
I recently put a question on my social media about what people thought were the two greatest science fiction books of all time.
Ooh.
And one of the surprising answers was Tunnels in the Sky by Robert Heinlein. And that's a book that's 80 years old now.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, I read it once upon a time, but I thought, man, it's probably worth picking up again. So I downloaded it. I've been blasting through it. And it's still good stuff.
Yeah. Heinlein didn't write much that was bad.
No,
for sure.
No, yeah.
What's your social media so people can connect with you?
The blog is thepatdaly.com, and then I'm at Pat Daly Author on Twitter. And Pat Daly Picks on Insta and Pat Daly Author on Facebook.
Okay, cool. So yeah, reach out to Pat and tell him what your favorite sci-fi book has been. I know one of my my great favorites is of course the entire series of The Hitchhiker's Guide. can't beat that for much.
Yeah, good stuff.
Yeah. when I graduated, when I got my bachelor's in business admin, I was able to give a speech during the commencement. And, well, technically it wasn't a commencement. Technically it wasn't the valedictorian speech, but that's basically what it was. I managed to work into my speech references to about a dozen sci-fi series.
Oh, excellent.
And the only one who noticed was my youngest brother. Who I actually had surprised him and my parents and my pastor at the time. None of them knew I was graduating from college. My parents didn't even know I was going. And I managed to get my parents to change their travel plans because they live out in Missouri, and I was going to school out here in California. And I got them to move their travel plans up by about 3 months without telling them why. I told them I was giving a speech to a consortium of business personnel, and it would be an honor for me to have them there. And so they flew out, and we all went. A dear friend of mine helped me get them from Santa Ana to Norwalk, which is a trip of about 45 minutes, depending on how traffic is. And they got there, and they're like, "Wait a minute, what is this?"
I'm trying to get from how your parents couldn't know that you were even going to college.
I really didn't tell anybody. I had, cause I took the 20-year path to my 4-year degree. And, so I kind of decided I liked the program and decided to go. And decided that instead of disappointing anybody again by telling them that I was going and working toward it, I just did it. And
what degree did you get?
I got a bachelor's in business administration, focusing on marketing and management. And from a university called Northwood University. They're out of Michigan. They're a private nonprofit. Great school. Kind of a libertarian bent on things. They were pretty famous a while back because what's her name? She ended up being Secretary of Education under George Bush.
I have forgotten her name intentionally. Sorry.
They actually put up the money for one of the buildings at the university. The university is much better than her reputation would seem to imply. But I learned a lot, learned a lot about myself, really, that I had talents in economics and strategy and leadership. Fell in love with actually teaching leadership, and I still do that a bit today. I have a couple day gigs. One of them is I help people get their business online set them up with a CRM and all sorts of automated AI supported features. And it's like a combination between a bunch of different services. And then I've kind of taken a break from it right now, but I teach leadership development using a model I call the ethical leadership model. And it has a lot of great actionable behaviors is how I say it. Because you got to say it in a buzzworthy type of way. Humility is the prime mover in it. And I found that it really helps bring teams together. And I just really enjoy helping people become better leaders. So what do each of you do in your day jobs? Dr. Janice, let's start with you.
Right now, well, I'm an author, a teacher, and a speaker. But I haven't been doing much with it lately. I've written a couple of books.
Awesome.
I was a principal and then higher up in the educational arena.
Okay.
Assistant superintendent of public schools. Then I worked for a few nonprofits, and then I became a consultant, and then an author. And as people do when they move their way up into freedom to do what you want to do and say what you want to do the way you want to say it, which is really what caused me to move out. I just always felt constrained within the public education confines of how I wanted to speak. And even though I dedicated myself to public education because I believe in it so strongly, but it was nice to break free and then become a speaker trainer about the combination of my spiritual beliefs and educational beliefs have come together. So I can now speak freely about those together. So today I'm not actively, I'm speaking when people want me to speak, but I'm not doing much to make it happen. So you came along and I said, okay, I haven't done that in a while. Let's do that. So let's see if there's anybody out there that's interested in hearing about the aha moment, which is what I speak about.
Yeah, I saw that in your little intro, in your questionnaire, and was wondering about that. I was cleaning out my car the other day and had a can of aha sparkling beverage. And then I saw your aha moment and I'm like, oh, okay.
No coincidences.
No. There's a, speaking of science fiction, back to science fiction, the callback. One of my favorite sayings comes from a show called Deep Space Nine. And the character says, how's it go? I believe in coincidences. Coincidences happen all the time, but I don't trust them. They're too convenient.
Yeah.
I think somewhere out there, somebody's planning a lot of these coincidences.
Well, it depends from where you're looking at, how you're looking at the coincidence. If you believe in destiny, then it's just unfolding perfectly. You know, and then the coincidences are recognized because there's probably, I would guess, everything is a coincidence and only occasionally do we tune into seeing them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What, Rudy?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Are they Christians?
I don't know. I didn't ask.
Oh, okay.
Rudy's always interested in knowing that of our guest, Dr. Janice. You said that that you combine your spirituality with education. What is your spiritual bent, if you will?
People ask me if I'm Christian, and I say yes, but traditional Christians will say no. So I've been told that I'm wrong in my beliefs by many Christians. And so I believe I am because I believe in Jesus' words and completely and follow them to the best of my ability. But because I believe more than that, I don't fit into the narrow confines of Jesus Christ being the only Savior that has walked on earth. I have a guru in India.
Okay.
And I have all the spiritual path, reincarnation, karma, and so on and so forth. All that that entails.
I ask that because destiny. I think a lot of times how I met Leah is because God sent me a place that I would never go. It wasn't a bad place, but I ended up going, and God led me to Leah that helped me. That's why about that. When she said destiny, A lot of times I think the hand of God puts us in different places to progress ourselves into being a better person. That's what.
Can you hear them all right, Ernie?
I can hear them.
Oh, okay. Oh, can't hear me? No, I can hear you. I can't hear you through my headphones, but I can hear you.
Okay. Yeah, that's
this is something new we're trying, having Rudy actually participate in the show.
Because I love his guests. His guests are great.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I have the best
guests. Speaking to my Christian.
The first book I read was Cat in the Hat.
What was that?
The first book I read was Cat in the Hat. Last week.
But to answer the question that wasn't asked, Rudy's wife, Leah, she passed away 4 years ago this last Sunday. She was my best friend, and I helped her through her final years. Rudy and I grew close, and we're friends still today, and roommates, in fact. So, definitely not coincidence that everything came forward to where we are today. The question between predestination and free will is always an interesting and troubling one. That's for sure. How destiny unfolds and how much hand do we play in our destinies and how much of it is pre-planned for us is something that definitely troubles my soul. So, Pat, you've been quiet.
Yeah, well, okay, to get back to a couple of questions ago. I am a Christian. I consider myself one. Mm-hmm. To address something Jana said, I think personally that when people think they have the full answer, mm-hmm. they don't understand either science or God well enough. Mm-hmm. And I can't conceive of a universe where they don't coexist and are interdependent. So, mm-hmm. so if people think they've got all the answers and say, well, you can't be a Christian because you believe in science. Well, I think that's misguided.
Yes. That's a good word to put it. That's a good way to put it. Yeah, I definitely believe in a God of laws, and science definitely is the exploration of those laws. I believe when the Bible and science appear to disagree, it's not because one of them is wrong, one or both of them is wrong. It's because we don't understand everything yet.
Yep.
Well, science is on the brink of discovering what Christians would call the Holy Spirit or mm-hmm. the creative force. Mm-hmm. Science will define it as quantum physics or whatever, but they're science is just coming along with, undeniable evidence of the creative force.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep. And it's funny. I've met very few people who literally don't believe in anything. Most people I've met who profess to be atheists believe in at least a creative force behind the universe. They just don't particularly believe in a certain God and set of belief systems. It's an interesting study. That's for sure. So Pat, your question, what are you doing? What do you do during the day?
Okay. Well, I got a couple of things. Yeah. A couple of things going on. I'm the director of safety for an airline. And then, I do outside consulting in, advanced technology flight test stuff. Currently working on alternate fuel aircraft, an electrically powered one, and then also a hydrogen powered vehicle. And we should see first light of that full scale hydrogen powered vehicle here within the next week or so.
Oh, that's exciting.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, I didn't realize that airplanes are, I never knew that they were such a great contributor to pollution. I never really understood that. We really can't do without them. And so I'm so happy to hear that you are working on the alternatives to make them environmentally better.
Yeah. Yeah. And well, I mean, you know, there's no such thing as a free lunch. And so even though the propulsive force may be pollutant free, the stuff that it takes to build that may not be.
Yeah.
So we, you know, there's just a lot of stuff to look at, and I think it's worth looking at, because I think we can certainly reduce our pollutive impact on the planet.
Yeah. Yep. Good stewards. That's something, I believe in efficiency as well. You know, some people have called me a tree hugger, and if liking clean air and clean water is being a tree hugger, then I'm definitely guilty. But I like my car. I have a little Pontiac 2-seater Roadster, and it pollutes.
Is that one of the PT Cruisers?
No. I have a Pontiac Solstice.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, one of the last good car that Pontiac made, and definitely since they've gone out of business. I like fast cars, but I believe in efficiency. You know, making the most of what you have is definitely a great way of getting closer to zero pollution. Building stuff that maybe are zero pollution in tailpipe, but controlled and directed somewhere else, you know, like a power plant or a hydrogen producing facility. You know, I would think that at least that way you could have it all in one location, and then you could work on how that location pollutes. You know, at least you can control where it's polluting then.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And there's still so much we're learning about how we can mitigate some of the effects of hydrocarbons and other fuels that we use. And then I'm a big advocate for solar and wind power as well.
I like wind power. Wind power is kind of fun.
Yeah.
So I just heard a very sad story about wind power the other day, to your point about what we have to do to get to the point to be environmentally conscious. In the Northeast, whatever they do to test where they can put the windmills into the ocean, they put off a huge sound, a huge bang, which was killing hundreds of whales.
Oh,
because
goodness.
Whales, of course, deal with sound. And so they're just washing ashore because we're trying to be environmentally correct. It was a horrible story.
Yeah. Yeah. We definitely tend to do a lot of damage when we're trying to figure things out.
Yeah. And wind power, although it's, you know, exceptionally clean, it, beyond the noise that you bring up, Janice, it also, I mean, those big windmills are bird slicers. Because they just don't see them. Maybe if we painted owl eyes on them. I'm not really kidding. You know, they do it on the spinners for jet aircraft to make the aircraft appear, at least in that tiny little bird cranium, as a larger airborne predator. Yeah, maybe we do that on windmills too.
Yeah,
maybe. Yeah, it'd be an interesting study to find out what would keep them. Oops. Sorry, I have a little table, and sometimes when I move, it bounces the camera. That would be interesting to do a study and find out what would make it more effective against bird collisions with those with those big old windmills. We've got a bunch of them out here in Palm Springs, which is a couple hours away. Huge farm full of these giant wind turbines. And you know, it's always I've seen videos of the blades breaking off and flying through the air, and whenever I have to drive that way, I'm always a little wary.
Yeah. And justifiably so.
Yes. Because they are very big. A lot bigger than they look.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it really opens your eyes when you see one of those turbine blades traveling down the road. And, I mean, they're enormous. They're enormous. They're an extra long trailer behind that semi carrying that.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. For sure.
Okay, you mentioned before we were on air that you write sci-fi for young adults.
I do.
Being an educator, I'm curious whether or not you're bringing kids back to reading real books, because most of them are on their devices looking at sci-fi kind of things and experiencing AI and so on. So can you grab these youngsters and bring them back to the written page?
Well, I hope so. It's hard to compete with the screen. And so my books are also published in e-formats. And yet, the best feedback I've gotten have been from kids and adults that have actually held the physical book in their hands and read it. And if I could pull, you know, an entire generation back to the printed word, I would love to do that.
Yeah. I hope so. I don't know. I don't have much faith. I'm scared about that one, being an educator, and I know the power of reading and the power of books and so on. And I, too, am reading my new book on my iPad, not physical, you know, not with a physical book, but still reading. I mean, but it's just trying to get people to even engage long enough to read is such a challenge these days.
It is, and I've had lots of requests for the audiobook. And I actually tried to launch one of those that I was self-funding, and it didn't go well. I struggled to get the reader to correctly pronounce words and to modulate their tone, and it ended up really sounding more like a used car advertisement. Come on down now, read Pat Daly's books. Everything's going to be great. Everything was at high speed, high volume, and we ended up pulling the plug on the project. So maybe when I scrape together enough funds, maybe I ought to do a GoFundMe for a professional voice artist to read the book.
I've actually done that.
Have you? For your stuff?
Yeah, not for my stuff. For somebody else, I did the voice.
And oh, you did the voice.
Yes, I was. The voice.
Oh, very good.
What the voice sounds like.
Well, you have a nice voice.
If you wanted to know what the voice would sound like, this is it. Yeah. It's a very fun good. Project. I wanted to do some spiritual or some Indian kind of things, and there were just too many names. I couldn't pronounce the Indian names. I was a little shy of that. But the things that I didn't have any of those words in it, so it was fine. It was a really fun experience when I did it with my friend. I did it as a collaboration. I just gave him my voice. We had fun doing it together.
Did you do it in a studio, or did you have a studio in your home, or how did you make that all work?
There was somebody near him that had a studio in his home. And so we went to his home and his room and did it there.
Very good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. No, that's awesome. Not often you find an author who also does the voiceovers. And would you do your own book, or would you get somebody else to do your book? Yeah,
I would love to do my book. I've never thought about doing it. I like I said, it's not. I'm not even. I think there may be another book. I wrote a memoir during COVID about my life. It called. Let me see what I called it. the ahas of my life. It's a combination of the moments of my life and my spiritual interpretation of them. And it's very well read by people that I know and people I don't know when I give it to them, but I haven't worked on doing anything with it. But that might be something I would consider doing. But I don't even have plans for that book, but it, you know, who knows? I'm just sort of hanging here with a lot of ideas and not knowing much about it right now.
Sometimes it's hard to get back up on that motivational step and actually do the work, because sometimes, you know, people don't often appreciate that writing is work.
Yeah.
Right.
And it's sometimes the ideas flow nice and smoothly, but sometimes going back and doing revisions is a painful, painful experience.
Well, you know, it's not even the writing. It's the thing that stops me is I just don't fit in the world anymore. You know, you're like on all those platforms. I have an Instagram account that I've never even looked at. You know, I'm just not up to snuff on any of that. And in order to be successful today in anything, you have to build your own following. And I just don't have an interest in doing that. So therefore, it's just, okay, I won't do it.
Yeah, I understand.
And the work comes in all that. The people I know that are moderately successful in creating a following, oh my gosh, the effort and the time it takes to make that happen. Yeah. It's enormous.
Yeah, my first publicist wanted me to tweet between 10 and 15 times per day.
Right.
Wow.
And I'm lucky if I can push out a blog post once a week, much less tweet that often. And it's because it maybe if that was your whole job, maybe right. If I was nothing but a full-time author and promoter, I could do it. But there's so much else going on in life that, I don't know, maybe the juice isn't worth the squeeze.
Well, it's another whole set of skills.
Yeah.
You know, that I don't have any interest in. And I also have a very hard time promoting myself, you know, because you're just all about promoting yourself. That's why back in the day when you had publicists or people doing that for you, you know, the artist or the writer or whatever did their art. And somebody else took care of all that. Well, in today's world, we do everything on our own for ourselves. And God bless the beautiful singers and musicians and artists that are out there that, you know, I just have ideas on a page, but there's so many beautiful people out there that are not being heard or seen simply because they don't have the vehicle to be heard and seen.
Yeah. Although it's gotten much better than it used to be. I mean, there was a time when it was really, really difficult to get your music out there or your written word. And now self-publishing is a huge thing. There's tons of support for it. As well as self-publishing music. I mean, things like YouTube and Twitch and all these other resources that people have for themselves today. It's just crazy.
Well, I thought about that. Oh, sorry.
That is the next step. So once you do that, so you self-publish your book or your music or whatever, then it's up to you to create whatever it is, the following that's going to buy or listen or watch. And that's the part that I just haven't figured out or need to hire somebody else to do or whatever.
Yeah.
If it were to be.
Well, yeah. my business partner actually has a sister site to my own, where I provide a done-by-yourself kind of solutions for all the social media following and the business of the internet. He does the done-for-you side, where they process all of all the social media stuff and all that. And he does pretty well at it because you're right. It's a different skill set. It's, you know, it's not the same as writing a piece of music. And it can be really difficult for some people to do it on their own.
Well, and the sheer volume of stuff, every day, every single day, 2,500 new books get published.
Wow.
And so how do you rise above that noise level?
Right.
Okay. And like Dana says, you got to make more noise than the rest of the crowd to gather those followers to get your stuff out there. Well, that's a big hill. Yeah.
You can't just make any old noise.
Yeah. And it's, you know, okay, so I have so many followers. Well, they're probably going to already buy and read my stuff. It's the getting beyond them,
right,
to their friends and whatnot that we need to worry about, or
it's,
I need to worry about.
You as the author.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's what I'm saying. You're a wonderful author, but you have to be your own publicist and your own promoter and your own marketer on an ongoing, very consistent basis. So,
yeah.
I mean, to me, I look at the talent in any field of artistry, and you can see great talent, but there's as many or more better artists, better musicians in any field, better writers that just are not out there because they haven't had the break, they haven't had the conditions, the circumstances, or whatever. It breaks my heart, actually, to see artists that are not being shown or heard.
Sure. Yeah.
Well, I belong to a networking group that combines business owners with musicians, and called M&O. And the philosophy they use is that the musicians don't compete with each other, even if they're in the same genre. Fans will listen to music by more than one artist. And I would think that to some extent, people would read books from more than one author too, although there's only so much time in the day to read everybody's books. I mean, I've got books I have yet to read, and they stand there waiting for their time to come. I would think there could be collaboration between authors to get more readers.
Absolutely. And here's one of the weird things. I go to book fairs, I go to book signings, and, you know, go to some comic cons, and I try to make the rounds of all the other authors and look at what they're doing. And without fail, I buy something from everybody, you know, one of the author's books. And I make the promise that, hey, I will read it and I will review it on my blog, you know, and then I can also put it on, you know, Amazon and Goodreads and stuff like that. And they go, oh, great, great, great. That would help a lot. And the unspoken ask I leave behind is, now, why don't you do the same for me? Yeah. You know, we're all scrambling around for this. And sadly, but overwhelmingly, they don't come by my table. They don't come by my booth. And even if they do, they end up not buying anything. And well, okay, maybe they're electronic only. They're going to get it off, you know, off Kindle or something. And yet, come on, let's help each other out.
Yeah. Well, what goes around comes around, so you'll be rewarded somehow or another. You've sown some things that you'll reap.
Yeah. I did, however, this past year, I changed my criteria for finishing a book. I used to, if I started a book, by God, I was going to finish it. And now I give it three chapters. And if after three chapters I can't stand it, I'm just going to toss it. And I'll skip reviewing it because I don't want to give anybody a one or a two star review. I don't know.
It's so hard to give somebody a low rated review. You know, even if they do deserve it.
Yeah. Yeah, and you think that, you know, I'm hiding on the other side of the internet. Who cares if I offend them? It's almost like internet culture is we expect to troll people and bash people, and yet I just can't do it. You know, if it's bad, maybe I'll give them a private message and say, you know, get an editor because you're averaging 42 typos per page and you don't know the difference between there, and there, or so get some help.
Yeah.
Pat, are you a self-published author, or do you have a publishing house that works with you?
My first book was self-published, and then after that, the second book was ready, and the publishing house found itself in financial straits.
Uh-oh.
And wanted to put off publishing my book, you know, an additional year and a half.
Wow.
And I write near future stuff. And so if I push it off a year and a half, you know, technology, science may have surpassed my book. So, so at that point, I just decided, I'm doing it on my own.
Yeah, a year and a half, and you suddenly become yourself a historical fiction author.
Yep.
Well, tell me something about the near future that has come true, you know, that you've written about, and then here we are, it's true, it happened, or it's going to happen.
I've written a lot about AIs being indistinguishable from human beings. Mm-hmm. ChatGPT from OpenAI. I mean, Janice, you were in the educational space. That's got to be a professor or teacher's biggest nightmare.
Yeah.
When somebody can produce something that is original. And is not theirs.
Right.
Yeah.
And so you can't just search against you know, published works, because it's all new. They're gonna be the first ones to publish it. So that worries me. But I think also and I talk a little bit about this too, that AI is gonna come to the rescue there as well. And they'll be able to pick up markers in the text or something, and you know, Bing AI is gonna go, no. That's not Pat's words, that's ChatGPT's words, and be able to figure it out somehow. So I think we have some help in that way. And then I think also we're gonna get more and more to virtual learning and AI guided learning.
Give me an example of that.
Sure. Let's take ChatGPT and push it to the next level, which I think will be to in 3 or 4 years.
You're going to have to explain that to people that don't know what that is.
Okay, a company called OpenAI has created a chat bot that you can interact with online that will answer questions for you. It's a little bit like Siri, but you can also say, hey, please create for me an original blog post in the style of Janice Fletcher on the topic of optimal wisdom learning. And as you watch, it prints out 1,000 words on exactly what you've asked it for. And you can engage it in conversation, like, what do you want out of life? And it'll engage and...
Can you hear on the phone?
Sorry?
Did you hear me on the microphone?
No.
Yeah. Oh, well, I can.
Well, the different.
Oh, you guys can hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, sorry, I just put my other plug-in for the headphone. God bless you guys.
Okay.
So anyway, you know, these things are passing the initial Turing tests, and people interacting online cannot distinguish them from another human being.
Yeah.
So you look at what teachers in public schools go through these days as far as behavioral issues with students, and the whole class gets slowed down because the teacher has to focus on little Pat Daly over in the corner making noise and misbehaving. And so that detracts from everybody's learning experience and, you know, frustrates the teacher, frustrates the kids. Well, now let's take let's expand it a little bit. Are you familiar with Data from the Star Trek universe?
I am.
Okay. Yeah. He's a human-like android. The only way you can really tell he's not human is he's got yellow eyes and white skin. So now you have someone that physically looks like a human being. And even going back to Terminator 2, you know, when Arnold turned into the good guy, he's the perfect teacher. He is never going to run out of patience. He can focus completely on one student, one individual, and give them all its attention, and therefore accelerate when the student is getting a subject, slow down, go into more detail when they need a little more help with conjugating verbs or something. So I think AI, artificial intelligence, is going to fundamentally change the education space.
Well, you give me hope, actually. No, I'm really quite despondent over what's happening with education today, and the challenges are just overwhelming for teachers, principals, the whole system. It's just almost impossible between the violence and the regulations and the and lawsuits and the, you know, it's just impossible to even do the job, I think, anymore. So you really do give me hope that there may be a solution that could be better. Although that means we have to fire all those people.
No, because I think you'll still need the human interaction. But you take a lot of the weight off of them. And my wife is a teacher. She's taught fourth grade in public schools in Texas forever. And, you know, she's had students try to stab her with scissors. She's had students throw things at them. And, okay, this is just me. This is not my wife's opinion. I believe that as a society, we are pushing more and more fundamental parental responsibilities onto teachers while simultaneously forbidding them to use parental tools. So it's.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. What we have to remember is what's going on in the classroom is just a microcosm of what we have created in society. So we want to blame the teacher, we want to blame the schools, but it's exactly when you're just taking society and bringing it into the classroom. So, you know, you summed it up there about the challenges. It's very frustrating. So
can I jump in real fast?
AI solution.
What were you?
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
See, where I grew up in the projects, and the first thing a teacher should ask in the elementary district is, can you guys read? I didn't learn how to read until I was 16. And what it was is the projects is because the grammar school you went to, a lot of them guys didn't care because they knew we were from the projects, so they didn't care about who they think we were going to die. And then junior high, those guys wanted to kill us because they were from a different neighborhood than we, and we went to go visit them in junior high, so they wanted to kill us. And then when we went to high school, them guys wanted to kill us because of where we live. So it was all gang related. And the thing is, there's some teachers that did put a little bit of love. The lady that taught me how to read, I wish I could remember her name. I love her so much, and I remember her because she sat back and she figured out. I didn't know how to read. So she would take me outside the class, would sit on the steps, and she would show me little cards like cat, dog, and then she would explain what the letters sounded like. So once in a while, you grab good people that do, because my wife was a teacher too, and but she did little kids. But what it is the first question they should ask every grammar school kid is, can you read? Because I know if I would have said, because I used to get in trouble a lot because I couldn't follow, so I would do whatever I want because I couldn't read. So the first question they should ask every kid in the grade that you're supposed to, because I don't know what age you're supposed to start learning how to read, but they should ask every kid in grammar school, can you read? Let them prove that they can read. Let them prove that they can understand the story. I forgot what they call that word. But see, what it is that's the thing that's bad because they when I grew up, everybody wanted to kill us outside of our block. So that was a thing that when I got older, I went to a continuation school, and it was gangs there. My friends were there, and then they were going to fight the other guys, and some guys tried to – I was walking home, and some guys tried to hit me in the head with a 2x4, and it was funny. I go, why do I want to go to school? I got to do all this stuff, and I might end up killing somebody. But what it is we got to ask the question to the little kids, and they can read. Because once you learn how to read, you can read the directions how to do math. You can read the directions how to do this. Even now to this day, well, I think I'm dyslexic, but there's things that I still can't pass, and it bothers me. And when I went back to school to try to learn, I was still stuck in my fifth grade because I got kicked out of school out of the fifth grade, and I went to like crazy schools, continuations that everybody was just didn't want to learn. We just wanted to be tough. All right, thank you.
Yeah, and I think a lot of it also has to do with parental involvement. I've noticed that schools that have higher levels of parental involvement tend to perform better. Regardless of the circumstances of the neighborhood, other than that, a friend of mine not too long ago was telling me he was on a parent teacher call, and the parent said in no uncertain terms, from 9 to 3, he's your problem, and it's like, wait a minute, don't you care about the future of your child?
Yeah, it's a terrifying thing. Because so many kids end up in situations where they don't have a set of loving parents. Mm-hmm. And a set of parents that will help them learn to read, because if a kid has two parents that are involved in their lives, then chances are that child is going to be well on the path to reading before they hit first grade. And they would never consider the possibility that their child could make it to high school and not learn to read. And Baltimore has a horrible problem. Baltimore Public Schools, they just fired their superintendent, who was getting paid $400,000 a year, which is not bad coin, tough job. I'm going to certainly agree to that. And yet their pass rate for standardized testing was in math was zero. And one parent of a senior. Okay, so think about this in terms of parental involvement. Partway through their child's senior year, they determine that their child has a grade point average of, now don't hold me to the exact numbers, but the first number, the one in front of the decimal point,
yeah,
was a zero. 0.29 maybe, something like that. Okay, that's horrifying. That means that in their whole high school career, they had passed one, maybe two classes. Okay, so even more horrifying is where they stood in the school's order of merit.
Uh-oh.
They were in the top 50%.
Wow.
So I'm with you. I think it takes parents. I mean, I think there are some parents who shouldn't be parents. And so let me spin this back around. How do we prevent parents or human beings who don't want to be parents from becoming parents? Is that the state's responsibility? Should it be individual responsibility? Should there be, you know, universal, completely accessible birth control available? And I'm talking proactive, not reactive birth control. So I'd be looking for birth control that takes place prior to conception. But what's our responsibility as a society?
Well, I guess the organizations that protect children, you know, every state and county has their own child protection departments, are the ones that are in charge of policing parents, if you will. So if you abuse your child or neglect your child, it will be that organization that will come in and possibly take your child from you or whatever needs to happen to assure that the child is safe and so on. So perhaps it is that level that will be the one to determine whether or not you are passing the parental guidelines. Maybe that is what needs to be more enforced. I mean, you're looking at so many rights, my right to have a child, my right to be able to parent the way I want. You know, what you think is good parenting, I may think is abused often, you know, and so on. So there's so many variations of personal rights in that question. I mean, we do have societies that do control that completely. You're allowed to have one child and so on. You're allowed to have two, and that's all there is. That's pretty, talk about a United States that is holding on to their rights, you know, and very concerned about their rights. That would be a hard thing to move into, I would imagine. I would prefer to have the parents have to step up to become educated and nurtured and supported in becoming the parents they need to be.
Well, so much of it comes back to education, you know, educating people on how to not have babies when they're not ready to have babies, education on how to raise them once you have them, you know, and the importance of being a good parent.
Yes, it does all get back to education.
Yeah.
Yay, education.
Yep.
And it's, you know, a sad case right now, as you just exemplified with Baltimore. That's just one of many examples across our nation. And COVID, of course, took us back. I don't even know. I mean, it has shifted our entire society for schooling forever, I think.
Well,
and we'll move into hopefully the distance learning that you're talking about that may be more effective.
Well, I homeschooled at the end of high school, finished up early and did all that. But again, we're back to parental involvement. My parents were heavily involved in my education and making sure that I learned the right stuff and the stuff that I needed to. And I actually in high school got to develop my own course. Because neither of my parents are technically minded, and I wanted to have a class in electronics. So they said, well, design the course, figure out your outcomes, and make sure that you have a final project that you can demonstrate that you've learned something to us. Because if you give us a paper that says a bunch of formulas and theory and stuff, we won't understand any of it. And so I even did that in high school. And did very well. You know, I think if parents either were of the bent or of the ability or availability even to help their kids, COVID wouldn't have been a thing as far as education goes, because kids would have been at home, their parents would have been involved in their educations ongoing. And you know, we wouldn't have lost these. Some estimates I've heard that they've lost basically the 2 years that that everything was shut down for COVID. And
Well, it's forced us into a new lifestyle in society everywhere. Everybody's working from home. All the only demand to work from home, if possible, so on. So the individualized creating your own course and having the AI teacher help the parent and or the teacher individualize what you need and so on is the answer. We're not going to go backwards. I don't think. We're going to get more and more individualized, and people are going to be responsible not only for promoting their own artistry, but their own education and so on. And we are in the world of transparency now. So perhaps, as you were saying, when you get to the point of creating something, there'll be some chat that can say that it is in fact true. Because I was explaining to my friend the other day that you let nobody can tell the truth anymore. You don't know what's true at all. In the world, there's just no way to know if that's real or true or honest. And it's like, I don't even know what to do with that. I don't even know that, but I know that that's the case. Is that really Bill there on the video, or is he a hologram? He could be a hologram. Seriously, so am I talking to an alien or am I talking to a real person? How do I know? I don't know.
Lizard people.
And Janice, that is a great, great point that the line between reality and not just virtual, which is stuff I write about a lot, but reality as perceived by individuals is getting really, really fuzzy. And your questions about, hey, are Bill and I aliens, or are you the alien? That's a valid one.
Yeah. I got things coming out of my head.
I do love that painting, by the way. I told you that before we started, but I think it's great. And maybe move to the side so everybody can see that the centerpiece.
See, it goes with my book. This is my book, Teach with Spirit. So that's the owl, and her name is Prosperity. And so it's sort of the same,
Yeah.
The next book will be different, I guess, but that's where that comes from, for my aha moment. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the painting is quite profound.
Now, Janice, did you self-publish?
Right. It is a real painting. I can go touch it right now.
I'm going to get this out there. Yeah, or at least your image will appear to touch the image of the painting.
Pat is frozen now. What does that mean?
It means the internet's got to catch up here real quick.
Okay.
All right, can you hear me now?
Yes.
All right, good. Good. So sorry. I was going to ask you, Janice, are you self-published or did you go traditional publishing route?
A combination of both. I've written two books, and both books were published through a publisher, but it was a small-time publisher, so it's very close to being self-published rather than, a big publishing house. So technically, I did not self-publish, but the bottom line is the same. Even with the publishing companies that you choose to go with, how much are they going to do to promote you? And then how much falls on you? It has always thus far come back to me having to promote it further and so on. And until I guess something takes off or grabs the attention of the world or something, I don't know. Until it is your time and destiny that it's going to be noticed, it still falls back on the author to me.
Yeah. Yeah. And I have a friend who was published by the Little Brown division of Simon & Schuster, or maybe it's HarperCollins.
That's a good publishing company.
Yeah. And they got her books into a lot of school libraries.
Great.
And then that was it. You know,
that's what happens. It's like, yeah.
No real media buzz, no PR.
Yeah, you would think that that would. And I have a friend that's written spiritual books. He's won, I think, every award possible in that genre. I mean, he's got probably a dozen awards. His books are phenomenal. And he's not making any money on selling books.
Yeah, I've had a couple of guests say similar stories that you know, they've won a dozen or so awards in their genre. They're well respected and talked about in their circle, and that's as far as it goes.
Right.
Yeah, it's tough to be an author and to be a full-time author. You know, for sure. But to hope to make any kind of living off of it is definitely difficult.
Yeah.
Gee, and I'm hoping to do that.
Yeah.
Of course, I'm going to cheat. I'm going to basically write about podcasting. So
there you go. Yeah. And then you've already got a platform to advertise your book.
And I have material. So.
Yeah. So once you get that following, then it's almost like a self-spinning flywheel. It just keeps going and going and going. Brandon Sanderson, whose work I really enjoy and really admire, he's got, like, I don't know, 20 million followers, and, you know, he's been a best-selling author for a long time, and he pulled the plug on traditional publishing and made more with his first self-published book than he had with everything prior to that, because he, you know, got to keep more of it. But then that's also, first of all, really good author, that helps, and then second of all, already has a big following. So
yeah,
and
I mean, there's a reason why I ended up buying an $18 book on about Prince Harry or whatever we're calling him. That's the perfect example of how books get bought today. The interest, the following, that everything is already in place, you know, or whatever. So also, you know, like in your world, Pat, you were writing about new and different possibilities of science fiction for young adults, which is a fascinating new thing to write about. What I'm writing about spiritually, or the aha moment, everything's been said. I just have a slightly, not even different, but a different perspective of bringing it forth, but it's not new material. So whenever I think about going off into the world to try and tell the world about it, it's like, it's already been said in my world so many times. The spiritual beliefs I have, the things, it's already been said over and over and over, but your work is new and original. So that would be interesting.
Yeah, I hope so. And yet here I am reading 80-year-old Heinlein and loving it. You know, I've got some friends that advocate, you know, oh, you got to follow this. You got to use this beat sheet to create the plot for your book. And you have to, you know, it has to be rising action through the third act. And then you can have the resolution. And it's like, I don't know. You know, did Shakespeare ever plot his plays out that way? Maybe he did. You know, maybe he just had the intuitive sense, having grown up around plays, that's the way to do it. But
well, I think
have to
I
be
think
that way.
That has been classically the line, the pattern. My husband took off a few years, 4 years or so, to become an author, and then went back to his day job and so on. So there's a lot of writing going on between us. And so I know the world of the novel and the screenplay and so on. And it reflects life, really. there's a situation, there are people, then there's a conflict, and there's a protagonist, a natural one. You go through whatever crisis or whatever achievement or whatever, and then you have the conclusion, and that is the storyline. So that really does seem logical and has been the case forever. Although, like everything else in the world now, that too is shifting. You know, because stories are now being presented in movies and so on. They no longer have the happy ending, or they, you know, there's a lot of things shifting in that pattern as well. Although it feels, I'm just old, you know, so it feels very comfortable for me to have that pattern in place.
Yeah, and maybe that's it. Maybe it is a comfortable pattern so that people... Do they want to be pushed into a new story pattern, or are they just kind of happy where they are?
Yeah.
Maybe that's key to success.
Yeah. Well, we're all being pushed in society now to be, everything's different. Everything, you know, it's just completely different always. Every time I turn around, not only do I know if it's true or not, you know, I just had to stop watching the news. It was like, that's just the... Both sides are just saying the same thing about each other repetitively in the same way. So that's worthless. And then how much do we really know of what's going on? That's being spoon-fed. So that's worthless to even pay attention to or give my time to. So I don't know. You know, so, but, you know, whatever it is in the world, you want to travel, you know, you're doing it on your own. No matter what you're doing, even when we went to buy a car a few years ago, and of course, my husband had done all the research and found out the one car that was available. And he was the salesman. You know, he is the one that went and did the research on what car it was they wanted and so on. You know, we just went in and paid the price. But I mean, it's a different world everywhere.
Mm-hmm. And like you, I have stopped watching the news. I stopped watching or listening to the news on the radio because Janice hit it on the head. It's everybody's spinning it their own way. I think the days of Walter Cronkite and here are the facts, and you need to use your intellect to interpret these facts and figure out what it means to you. And so I tend to do consume all my news now via print because it slows the whole thing down. I'm not going to be swayed by whatever images they choose to project. I can read it, think about it, reflect, and think, well, you know, that's probably a little bit of spin or that not be completely accurate. It's just made my life a little calmer. Have you found that, Janice?
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's just no reason. No, I mean, what I find is I get the headlines just from the people around me, whether I want them or not. You know, they keep me sort of a little bit informed. And what do you know? There was an earthquake in Turkey. Okay, that was really bad. Okay, they got that. And do I need to see all the images? I don't know. You know, I don't. It's not helping me to see the images.
Right.
It just saddens me. And why do I want that? I mean, I can pray for them and wish them well and support them, but I don't need to dwell on the horribleness of it. That's just, you know, as an example.
Yeah. There's, the news is a terrible thing because it's an industry. It's, you know, a business like any others. And, you know, they have to have the sensational images, the sensational stories, you know, of this person is more evil than that person, and this horrible thing happened to these people, and all of those kinds of things. And you get a little spell from that by some soft news article, like an adorable puppy for a second or something. And then it's back to the horribleness. Because that's what sells. People tend to watch that stuff. So you can't entirely blame the news media, the news outlets, because they're just giving the people what they're paying for.
Yeah.
Yeah. Gotta sell airtime.
Once again, it just comes back to our own individual decisions of how we're going to experience life. Yeah. Are we going to spend our time paying attention to the news, or you know, are we going to spend our time doing creative things? And does it matter whether or not the world sees our creative things or not? You know, it just comes back to our individual plan of how we're going to experience life. Are we going to connect to the divine? Do we find that connection? Is it worth it for us? How, you know, do we dwell on that? You know, we just have to pick and choose what we're going to spend our time on.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm going to spend it doing podcasts.
Good plan.
Yeah.
And we support you.
Okay, awesome. And then I'm going to support my podcasting habit by placing an advertisement right here. It's less than 30 seconds, so don't go anywhere.
Attention entrepreneurs. Automate U is the all-in-one platform that will give you the tools, support, and resources you need to succeed with your business. With our all-in-one marketing and sales platform, you will be able to keep your tools in one place while saving a fortune and streamline your entire delivery process so you can focus on keeping your clients happy. Get your 30-day free trial at automateyou.co. That's automateyou.co.
Okay, we're back. I put the ad in post.
Okay.
That's the only editing I do. Is to put in the end credits now and the advertisement. So, wow, we've gone into some deep holes over our time here. Let's see. It's thepatdaily.com, right?
Yep.
And janicefletcher.com.
That's right.
Yay! I remember. And so people need to go and check those out so they can find out about all about you and your books and buy some and spread the word, all of that good stuff. Now let's see what else. What else is relevant? Yeah, how much do we really need to know about world traumatic events? I mean, does it really affect us? Should it? Should the earthquake in Turkey affect us? Or is it just something that happened at a world away?
You know, I feel conflicted about that a little bit. It's like as a human being, I feel some compassion for those people. But if you go back 150 years, I'd never heard about it. I remember reading, I don't know if it was Faulkner or Hemingway or something like that, and one of the characters is walking along a road and walks over a bridge and notices that the water level in the river is significantly higher than it was yesterday. And he has this little mental aside, oh, it must have been raining up in Bear County yesterday. And was that a better time when you had to deduce things from just observing the natural world and around you? I don't know. Yeah. No, I like knowing. I like being an engaged citizen. And then there's days where I'm just so disgusted with it, I want to resign from the human race and go live in a cave.
Well, that's why I get back to the point that we are literally needing to choose our own lifestyle. If we aren't consciously choosing what we're going to put our attention on, then we will be inundated by the world without any filter whatsoever. So just as I choose my religion or my faith in God or whatever, and I choose what I'm going to eat and I choose things, we need to be cognizant and aware and with a lot of barriers up of what we're going to allow in our life. So regarding the earthquake, I know the facts. I have my prayers ready. But and beyond that, if I want to support them, fine. If I need to know something environmentally about that for the world, great. But to be barraged with the negative images of the horrible, horrible things that have gone on is only going to affect me negatively. Other than compassion for them, there comes a point where it's a negative in my on my being. It's too much negativity coming in. It's unnecessary. I don't need to look at the gruesome details of it for me. For somebody else, it's a different story.
Yeah, reminded of my grandfather, my father's father, was a cop here in Santa Ana back in the day. And I asked him once if he felt as a person involved in the worst side of human nature through much of his career, if the world was really a worse place that now than it was then, or if we just knew more about it. And his opinion seemed to be that that the world is just as nasty as it ever was. It's just that now we know more. We get into other people's business. We hear more news. I mean, there's a 24-hour news cycle now. They used to shut the TV stations down at night, and so they didn't have to fill 24 hours a day, 7 days a week with news. So what do you think? Is it a worse world today than it was, say, well, I'm 50, so 50 years ago?
I've got it right here. The reason I had to go to my phone is because this came to me, and I actually put it on Facebook. As a post, it said that if you think things are bad today, consider the years of 536 to 545, when volcanoes blocked out the sun, the earth cooled, crops failed, and then the bubonic plague hit.
No.
So cheer up. So that was the 500s.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it could be worse.
Well, the point is, it doesn't matter what it is. It's how are we going to experience it? We have COVID, or we have the bubonic plague, or whatever we have. We have volcanoes, or we have earthquakes. It's happening. Mm-hmm. That's life. And so how are we then going to let life be lived through us?
Yeah. Well, and I think related to that is almost the social media culture, in that nobody posts, well, very few people post about, you know, I got up this morning, I stepped on the cat, I stubbed my toe, you know, the coffee maker didn't work. And it's not that. It's pictures of them in a beautiful location on vacation, or something carefully posed and curated. And I think, you know, this has been an issue since TV began, that people conflate actors with characters that they play. And so the poor kid that played Joffrey in Game of Thrones got death threats. You know what? That kid is actually just a human being with a job of portraying a loathsome character, when in fact he's probably a great human being. And so we see the face that people choose to show to us, I guess. And you may never know, you know, how bad things are over at the Johnson's house when the doors are closed. You know, you don't know what struggles they have. You don't know by looking at the three of us on screen here. We don't know what the others might be struggling with at this current time. We just know this aspect that we see of them now.
Yeah. We see what we see, but we can be sure whether or not it rained in Bear County.
Yeah. That's right. That's right. Or did the aliens just dump a ton of water
right
upstream? Or did the dam break?
Manufactured fact to make me feel better about, you know, who knows? You know, I'm in a very skeptical kind of period right now about what's coming at me.
Healthy dose of skepticism never hurt anybody. You know, maybe delayed them from doing what they really wanted to do a little bit, but I don't think it ever did any real damage.
Yeah. Oh.
Well, again, it doesn't deter me from it. It makes me go more inward.
Mm-hmm.
And to just be within myself and not in really detached from the world, so that, you know, I touch it a little bit here and there, but how much do I really get involved? It depends. I'm very, very careful and where I put my energy and with who and what I believe in. I've watched people give their entire life savings or their hard work for causes that were corrupt or, you know, that they didn't see that it was, you know, that they were just wasting it away, you know. So I think, again, we just look at ourselves and decide, do your own research. You know, when I'm going to give charitable dollars, I'm very careful where they go,
mm-hmm.
you know, because, again, that skepticism has proven, and in this world of transparency, there is not an industry that has not been scandalized. The scandals that are coming forth in every industry in the world now. Every country, every industry, everything is, you know, we are living in the land of transparency. So that's why people think that they can hide things. You all know better than I do how transparent everything is with regard to our technology and so on. You know, of course, we're being recorded here together, but we're also being listened to by whomever needs to listen to what we're saying and cataloging us as whatever they are determining or defining us to be. You know, it's just a very interesting world. So the only thing that you have is really yourself and your interactions with the world.
Yeah. A little introspection is a good thing, really. Being careful with your time, realizing what you spend your time on, and knowing that is showing what's truly important to you. You know, if you spend all your time at work, then obviously work is important to you. If you spend all your dollars on the Save the Whales campaign, then that's what's important to you. You know, have you ever reviewed how you spend your days? And figured out what's really important to you?
Yeah, it's an interesting thing. I recently read Viktor Frankl's Man's Search for Meaning, which is profound. One of the things that got me thinking about was the difference between purpose and meaning. And someone, I can't, this was not my theory, but it made sense to me that meaning is a retrospective look at your life. Have you lived a meaningful life? Whereas purpose is what drives you or maybe even pulls you forward. And when Frankl talks about the people that survived the Holocaust or other prisoner of war camps, they all had something that they were focused on in the future to move themselves forward. And I think looking at your life through that lens, what is your purpose? You know, is your purpose to get the highest score on Donkey Kong in the bar, or is your purpose to be a good partner, a good husband, a good father, you know, a good son, because you know, that's one of those things that I didn't really think about until my own father was dying. That, you know, I sometimes groused about, you know, he could have been a better father, but then I, you know, as he got closer to his life's finish line, I thought, could I have been a better son? And I think those kind of introspective moments are worth having, even if it's just checking out how much screen time you've had today and what have you done with that screen time. Because if you're just playing solitaire on your phone or something else, you could probably do something more purposeful or meaningful with your life. Okay, so that was a bit preachy. Sorry.
That's okay. We're coming near the end. We can.
Well,
do
you
that.
May want to think about the aha moment in that, mm-hmm. with that statement or that question, and how that happens is there the truth that comes through in an aha moment, the answer. For instance, what is your life purpose? Or what is it, the meaningful part of your life that you're going to go forth? Each of us have had an aha moment that have then propelled us into what it is that we're doing. There was a moment in time whether we didn't ask for it, it happened when we weren't expecting it. I can walk you through the steps, but the point is that truth came through as a knowing. Not as somebody telling you or something that you tried to make happen. It was a knowing that was an absolute truth that this is, I must be an author, I must be a podcaster, you know, I want to be a father, this is and the truth. So that is where you get what it is that's going to push you forward through the truth if you're open to hear it. Because the truth comes through, it's just that we're not listening. And that's where the paying attention to the aha moment and knowing that it comes through when your left brain is not engaged, when you're not trying to figure it out. You may have an underlying question, and what is the purpose of my life? And then somewhere, a year later, 2 days later, somewhere when you're not expecting it, poof, you know. And I'm sure that each of you can tell me at least one, if not more, times in your life where those truth moments of aha knowings came through and you acted on it.
Yeah.
Or in retrospect, should have acted on it.
That's true. That's the point is that the knowing is there. Mm-hmm. The truth comes through. Should I buy this? No, should I buy that? No, should I live here? Should I live there? You go back and forth trying to figure it out. Your mind is involved in figuring it out. And then finally, at some point, there comes a time where you say, I don't know. And you give up. And you don't try to figure it out anymore. That's where, you know, Google started playing ping pong to let the geniuses' minds, you know, be empty. And your mind empties out, you're walking the dog, you're taking a shower or whatever. It's like, oh, that's the house. That's it. I know that's the house I need to do. Or when you hear that that's the house that you should buy, it's like, no, I'm not going to buy that house. Why would I buy that house? And then 2 years down the road, you realize, wow, I should have listened because that would have been a better house to buy. So the truth comes through. It's just whether or not we're listening to it and acting on it. And the more we listen to it and the more we act on it, the more truth comes through, and the easier life becomes because we are living on true truth. And the truth is, and you can call that truth whatever you want, God speaking to you, divine intervention, or it's just the right brain. But Einstein referred to the left brain as a servant because it's like a computer. Whatever we put in, we get out. And then he said the right brain is a gift. It's truth. It's sacred truth that comes through. So that's the essence of my message in this world, is to bring people into themselves to hear that truth and live by that guidance, because then you can't go wrong, no matter what the issue.
Okay. Profound.
Profound.
Said
there's nothing new under the sun.
Right.
No. So wow, we've done this for quite some time now. I'm sure you've both got other things to occupy your time with than continuing jaw jack with me. But I will ask if you have any final words for the nice people. Dennis?
Thank you. Thank you so much, Bill, for having us.
It was my pleasure. This,
wonderful conversation. It was nice meeting you, Pat. And I hope you'll go forth with, you know, getting those youngsters enthralled with the possibilities of the future through science fiction and actually buying and opening a book or getting it out of the library. And to the world itself, I would say, if there's one message, please just listen within and bank on yourself.
Oh, I love that.
Trust yourself.
I love that. I'm going to be a little more crassly commercial.
Okay. Spark
buy
and
the
fire.
Books. Spark and fire. Buy the books. Read them. Leave reviews. Authors live and die these days based on reviews.
Yeah.
So please, it doesn't matter what you're reading, leave a review for others. Mm-hmm. You know, even if all you do is click on 5 stars and move on, that's good. But you know, thoughtful reviews are always nice.
Yeah. Say a word.
And Bill, Bill, thanks so much for having us. I really appreciate it.
Hey, it was my pleasure.
And Janice, it was great to meet you.
Yes. Nice meeting you.
Yeah, it was great having you each on the show again and together for the first time. Okay, great. Well, of course, you know, go to JaniceFletcher.com and go to ThePatDaily.com, buy and read some books and look within and spend a little time with yourself. Yeah, that's it. Everybody, be safe out there. Remember to wash your hands and stay tuned for the ending credits.
Thank you all for tuning in. This has been a presentation of Bald Spots Productions. I'd like to thank my producer, my beloved mother, Eileen Hatch. I, of course, am your humble host.
I'd really like to thank my Ed McMahon, Rudy Corlew.
Yes!
I would especially like to thank my special guest, Pat Daly, and Dr. Janice Fletcher. Support the show if you feel so led over on patreon.com. We're known as Bald Spots Pro. Don't you dare miss YWL Online. You can find us on Facebook, YouTube, and wherever fine podcasts are offered. Be sure to tune in next time for special guest Rob Ekno. Please be sure to like, comment, and share, you know, subscribe, follow, whatever it is you've got to do to kick that algorithm into gear and help us reach more people. That is the point, after all. If you or someone you know needs support now, call or text 988 or chat 988lifeline.org. 988 is the Suicide and Mental Crisis Lifeline here in the States.